This is a production of World Video Bible School. To God be the glory.
Hello and welcome to Lesson 12 of our studies in the parables of our loving Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Each lesson, I try to go over some material at the top of the program so that you can become more familiar with the parables, and I want to do a little bit of that today. Now, these are true or false. The word parable is not used in the Old Testament. True or false? Well, that's false. It is used. All right, number two, parables employ figurative language. That's true. Number three, there is no difference between a parable and a fable. Of course, that's false. Number four, parables were preeminently used by Jesus. And that's true. Now, while it is true that parables were found in the Old Testament, parables were preeminently used by our loving Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Number five, no point of doctrine that is not elsewhere clearly affirmed may be derived from an incidental parabolic reference. And of course, that is true. Number six, the setting of a parable does not help its interpretation. And of course, that's false. See, that's one of the rules. You need to know the setting. That will help you to interpret correctly the parables. Number seven, the book of John contains more parables than the book of Mark. Well, that's false. Number eight, the book of Matthew contains more parables than the book of Luke. That's false. Seems like that'd be the case since there's more chapters in Matthew, but that's not the case. Number nine, the book of Luke contains more parables than the book of John. That's true. Number 10, all parables start by saying the kingdom of heaven is likened unto. Of course, that's false. Some do, but not all of them do. Number 11, the parables prove that the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God are one and the same institution. And that's exactly right. You need to know that. Now, if you know anything at all about premillennialism, when you put the heat on premillennial people and tell them the kingdom is here, they'll say, oh, yeah, sure. The kingdom of God, but not the kingdom of heaven. But when you study the parables from Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you'll see the parables use the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven interchangeably, thus shooting down the thought that the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God are two different things. Well, we'll look at some more of that later. But right now, we want to study another great parable, the Good Samaritan, found in Luke 10, 25 through 37. The theme of this parable is true neighborliness. The main lesson is true neighborliness is limited only by opportunity. See, the Lord is going to deal with the issue of who is my neighbor. And you're going to see what brings that about. Again, the setting is very important. Many people tried to tempt Jesus. This lawyer tried to tempt our Lord. Notice the question was great. The motive was terrible. So in major point number one, as we look at Luke 10, 25, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempting him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Notice a lawyer was one who knew and studied the law of Moses. Now, we're not talking about a lawyer like a man who goes to court to try to defend or prosecute someone. But we're talking about one who knew and studied the law of Moses. Now, Jesus was tempted many times, not just Matthew 4, Luke 4. You know, a lot of people, they talk about the temptation of Jesus. And of course, when they say that, they think, well, we're talking about Matthew 4 or we're talking about Luke 4. No, in Luke 4, 13, notice, and when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. He let up on the Lord for a season. But he would continue to tempt our Lord. To what extent? Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." I want you to notice the Lord was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. Our Lord understands the concept of being tempted. Notice that eternal life is inherited, but one must do something to get it. Here you have this lawyer wanting to know, he's asking the Lord, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, if our Lord was like many of the modern day preachers, say, "Well, a man, smarten up, there's nothing you can do." See, our Lord did not believe that. Our Lord understood clearly there was something to be done in order to have eternal life. Now, how do I know that? Because he came right out and said it. In Matthew 7, beginning with verse number 21, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." The Lord says, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. I was in Malden, South Carolina one time and trying to teach a lady. And I was showing her, you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do this to become a child of God. And she said, "You know, Wesley, your problem is you're hung up on that word do. You don't have to do anything." Well, if you don't have to do anything, why did she want me to study with her? Not only that, if you don't have to do anything, why won't everyone be saved? And if you don't have to do anything, why did Jesus say, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven"? I said, listen, Jesus Christ was not afraid of that word do, and I'm not afraid of it, because it's Holy Spirit given and approved by the Godhead. And so I'm going to continue to teach one has to do something in order to be saved. Now, you can't work your way to heaven, but you've got to respond to God when God asks you to do this, that, or the other. In Galatians 3:18, the Bible says, "For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more a promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise." So this inheritance does not come by the law of Moses, but because of what Jesus Christ did for you and for me. In Romans 4:14, the Bible says, "For if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect." So it did not come by the law, but rather through Jesus Christ and through the New Testament. Major point number two. He said unto him, "What is written in the law, how readest thou?" Now the lawyer wants to know, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus Christ says, "Well, what's written in the law? How readest thou?" Notice inheriting eternal life is connected, friends, with what is written. Don't you ever forget that. That's why Jesus Christ could make statements like, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." That's why Paul could say, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." It's important that you and I understand what is written. It makes a difference, friends, how one reads the Word of God. The Lord says, "What is written, how readest thou?" Many people read the Bible through denominational glasses. And so when they put those glasses on and they go to the Bible, they read a verse and then they conclude a false premise because their preacher told them this or that was true. For instance, they might read John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." And they assume faith only because their preacher told them one could be saved by faith only. They forget that James says, you see then how that by works a man is justified not by faith alone, James 2:24. So how readest thou? Do you read the Bible through denominational glasses? Do you read the Bible through preconceived ideas? Do you read the Bible through prejudice? Do you read the Bible through hatred? How readest thou? And you're going to see this man did not read too clearly because he was prejudiced and did not realize it and did not want to recognize his obligation toward God. Well, I want you to notice Jesus overcame his temptations by saying, it is written in Matthew 4:4, Matthew 4:7, and in Matthew 4:10. When the devil tempted him, the Lord needed strength. Where did he find the strength? He found it in that which was written, the Word of God. That's where you and I have got to go for strength when we are tempted. On another occasion, they were trying to tempt our Lord and put certain propositions before him on marriage. And in Matthew 19:4, he answered and said unto them, have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? They were trying to see what the Lord's view was on divorce. And the Lord said, well, have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? And he goes on to say that they were to leave mother and father and cleave to one another. The Lord said that was the way it was in the beginning. That's the way God designed it. That's my view. Well, whatever the Bible view is, that ought to be your view. It ought to be my view. If you hold the Bible view and I hold the Bible view, then we'll see it alike. And that's the only way we'll ever be united in Christ Jesus. In Romans 1:16, Paul said, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. So then notice the power that's in God's Word. You know, when you go back to Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, the Lord spake and things came into existence. That's the power that's in God's Word. When he went to the tomb, that is Jesus, of Lazarus, when he went there, and he said, Lazarus, come forth. By the power of the Word of Jesus, he was raised from the dead. Friends, there's power in the Word. Now this lawyer wants to know, what might I do to inherit eternal life? And the Lord says, what is written? And how do you read it? So this is very important. Major point three, Luke 10:27, and he answering said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy strength and with all thy mind and thy neighbor as thyself. Notice the lawyer gave the right answer. He wanted to know, you know, what is written. The lawyer came back and said, I'll tell you what's written. You're to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. Now notice on another occasion, when the Lord was being tempted, Matthew 22, beginning with verse number 35, then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and prophets. Now I want you to watch this. The lawyer gives the same answer when the Lord says, what is written, that the Lord gave when another lawyer asked him, what are the two major commandments? What's the most important commandment? And the Lord said, well, to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, strength, and mind. The second is like unto it, love thy neighbor as thyself. Now, we'll make this point a little later, but want to make it here too. Do you realize that some of the answers that you give are just as good as the answers that Jesus Christ himself could give if he is here on the face of the earth? Now, let me illustrate that again. This lawyer gave the right answer. That's the answer the Lord would have given. If someone should ask me today, what must I do to be saved? And I tell him what the Bible says. That's all Jesus could tell him if Jesus was here upon the face of the earth. Tell him what the Bible says. And so then we need to give a Bible answer. When we give a Bible answer, we're given that which the Godhead agrees with, because they revealed it to start with. In Deuteronomy 6 and verse number 5, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might." And then in Leviticus 19:18, "Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord." And of course, there's those two great commandments upon which every commandment hinges. Major point 4, Luke 10, verse 28. "And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live." It is one thing to know the right answer. It is something else to put it into practice. See, a lot of people know the right answer, but they will not put it into practice. They know what God wants them to do, but they will not do it. And so then that's just as wrong as it can be. All of the Old Testament was hinged on these two commandments. But notice also all the New Testament is hinged on these two commandments. To put it another way, if you want to go to heaven, get right with God and your fellow man. I tell people where I preach, do you want to go to heaven? Just two things you got to do. Get right with God, get right with your fellow man, and heaven will be yours. You know, that's what the Bible's all about, being right with God and right with your fellow man. Now, some answers that we can give are as good as what Jesus could give. I made that point a moment ago. Told you we'd make the point again. Now, when this man gave the answer that he did, the Lord agreed 100%, that's right. He gave an answer as good as what Jesus could give. But now the question is, will he practice it the way Jesus did? See, that's the issue. Jesus said, "This do, and thou shalt live." Wait a minute, Lord. You're hung up on that word do again. There you go, thinking you got to do something. Well, the Lord didn't just think one had to do something. He said he had to do something. And you and I better be of the same mindset. Jesus realized that there was something to be done. So then you and I have got to realize there's something to be done. Notice we should all want to live. This life means to have spiritual life. In 1 Timothy 5, 6, "But she that liveth in pleasure is dead while she liveth." Notice she was living physically, but dead spiritually. Well, you and I don't want to be dead spiritually. We want to live spiritually. 2 Timothy 2:11, "It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him." Notice we're to die to sin, and thus we live to Jesus. And that's what we got to do to have spiritual life. In Ephesians 2, verse 1, "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins." Notice the Lord has made us alive, even though we once were dead in trespasses and sins. When we're born again, we have been quickened, and the word quickened means to be made alive. And so we're made alive again. In John 11, 25, Jesus said unto her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." Notice the resurrection is more than an event. It's more than just a happening. It's more than a day. It's a person. And the person that's behind it is our loving Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life." But that's true with spiritual life. See, Jesus Christ is the one who's behind that. He died for you. He died for me. Major point number 5, Luke 10, 29. "But he willing to justify himself said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor?" How many of us try to justify ourselves rather than doing the will of our Heavenly Father? You think about that. It is hard to believe that a lawyer did not know who his neighbor was. Now, he's acting like he doesn't know who his neighbor is. See, you got the question right. And he said, well, now, if you're going to do the will of the Father and do what's written in the Bible, I got to love the Lord my God with all my heart, soul, strength, and mind. And the second commandment is like unto it, love thy neighbor as thyself. Jesus said, great, you got it right. Now, who's your neighbor? And he acts like he doesn't know. He can't tell. In Luke 16:15, he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts, for that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God. The Lord condemned them because they tried to justify themselves in the sight of God when they were wrong and knew it. Now, friends, do you go around trying to justify yourself rather than doing the Father's will? Do I do that? If I do, then I'm in trouble in the sight of God. In Luke 18:14, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. We want justification, but we want God to do the justifying. If we go around all the time trying to justify our actions, well, the reason I wasn't at services because this, and making all these excuses rather than doing what God wants us to do. We need to do what God wants us to do. Notice he wanted to go to heaven on his own terms. That's what's wrong with people today. They want to go to heaven on their own terms. Some want to be in a man-made church, obeying a man-made plan of salvation, living a man-made system of morality, but it won't work. You and I have got to do what the Lord says. The lawyer seems to be pretending ignorance, but ignorance is no excuse. In Acts 17, beginning with verse number 30, the Bible says, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in the which he'll judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. Notice, at one time God winked at ignorance. Why? Because he had not fully revealed his plan, his scheme of redemption. Now all has been fully revealed. So ignorance is no excuse. Jesus teaches the following parable to get him to see the answer to his question. Now, who's his neighbor? The Lord's going to deal with that and show exactly who the neighbor is. Major point 6, Luke 10:30. And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. This certain man is evidently a Jew. We don't know that for sure. Went down from Jerusalem is literally true. When the Bible makes statements like that, you can check it out, and the amazing thing is how accurate it is. The Bible always gets it right. And the Bible does that when the people had not gone over there and done all this measuring and making sure the elevation is thus and so, but the Bible says he went down from Jerusalem. Now, the highway between Jerusalem and Jericho was infested with thieves, so much so that some referred to it as the Bloody Way. The thieves thought they'd killed the man. What's sad, this sounds a whole lot like America. And I'm sorry to say this country has stooped to that level. Well, major point number 7, in Luke 10:31, and by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Hundreds of priests lived in Jericho. It was only 17 to 18 miles away from Jerusalem. Here's a Jew, a priest, one who had been no doubt officiating at the services of the Most High God. However, he would not stop and help. Now, he's going to pass by on the other side. Now, those who worship God should have hearts of compassion. The priest did not. Can you imagine returning from worshiping the true and living God, see someone that needs help and no heart of compassion? In 2 Timothy 3:5, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Some people just have a form of godliness. They don't really practice godliness. And then in Titus 1:16, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate. When it came to this good work, this priest was reprobate. He wasn't going to be involved in it. And then in 1 Timothy 3, verse number 2, speaking of the qualifications of an elder, the Bible says a bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach. Notice, an elder is one that's to be given to hospitality. See, God wants us to be hospitable. He wants us to be a compassionate people. And yet the priest, he's going to pass by on the other side. In 1 Timothy 5:10, well reported of for good works, if she have brought up children, if she have lodged strangers, if she have washed the saints' feet, if she have relieved the afflicted, if she have diligently followed every good work. Well, who's to be taken into the number among the widows? The Bible says those who have shown compassion. Now, do you show compassion? Do I? Well, the priest could have made a lot of excuses, maybe, of why he chose not to help. He could have said, well, I was afraid for my life. Those thieves could still be in the area. Or he might have said, well, I've done my duty. I've been to worship. Or he might have thought, I'll be late in trying to serve God. Or he might have known a Levite is coming and he'll surely help. Or he might have looked at the man and said, well, he's not one of ours anyway. And so I'm not going to get involved. So we can make excuses all day long, but friends, that does not show compassion. You and I, we want to be a compassionate people. Now in Exodus 23, beginning with verse number 4, if thou meet thine enemy's ox or his ass going astray, thou shalt surely bring it back to him again. If thou see the ass of him that hateth thee lying under his burden, and wouldest forbear to help him, thou shalt surely help with him. Notice the Bible here is teaching the principle in the Old Testament. If you see an animal going astray, help your neighbor. If you see an animal that's under a tremendous load, help the animal. Here a man, a human being made in the very image of God, is in a ditch, dying, beaten, wounded. And a person who's supposed to be a priest won't even help him. And the Lord is trying to get across the point. Now, is that a neighbor? Well, the lawyer's going to know, no, that man wasn't a true neighbor to the man that was fallen among the thieves. Major point 8, Luke 10:32, and likewise a priest, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. Notice he was following the lead of the priest. You know, a lot of times people in local congregations don't do any better because the leadership doesn't do much. Well, here you see the priest, he doesn't do anything, so the Levite doesn't do anything. He did take the time, however, to look at him. Can you see him just leaning over and, man, he's hurt. But he didn't help. He didn't do anything to try to assist him. He passed on the other side. Then major point number 9 in Luke 10:33, but a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. Now for the origin of the Samaritans, go back and read, if you will, 1 Kings 17. That'll give you some background for this study. But you know, the Jews hated and despised the Samaritans. When you read John 4, verse 9, then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, unto Jesus, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. You want a drink of water from me? Well, I thought you would have understood the Jews don't have any dealings with us Samaritans. And that's really the way the Jews treated them. And then in John 8:48, then answered the Jews and said unto him, say we not well that thou art the Samaritan and asked a devil? When they wanted to insult Jesus, they called him a Samaritan and one who possessed a devil. Now that's what they thought of the Samaritans. The man indeed received help from the one he least expected it from. If anyone had an excuse not to help, the Samaritan did. Now, he didn't have an excuse, but he could have thought, well, they treat me like dogs anyway. Why help? But see, that wasn't his attitude. In Matthew 20, 34, so Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight, and they followed him. Notice Jesus Christ was a man of compassion, and we're to be like Jesus, so we're to be people who are compassionate people. Well, here's some possible excuses, you know, the Samaritan could have made. He didn't make them. Well, our religion's different. I'm not going to get involved in this. Oh, he's of another race, and they think we're dogs. Well, he doesn't expect help from me anyway. So he could have made all these excuses, but he chose not to make excuses, but rather to help in trying to administer to the needs of this individual. In Luke 17, 16 beginning, and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. He was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, were there not 10? Where are the other 9? This is the cleansing of the 10 lepers. And the only one who returned was a Samaritan. And the Lord said, well, I thought I healed 10. Where are the other 9? They didn't even bother to come back and say, thank you. Well, major point number 10, Luke 10, 34. And went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. Notice the Samaritan was willing to use his goods to try to restore the injured man to his health. Oil was a good medicine back then. He put the injured man on his own beast or animal. He took him where he could get additional help. He took him to an inn. Notice, if you will, the principles of Christianity will cost you something and will also cost me something, because I'm obligated to be a good neighbor. I'm obligated to administer to the needs of those round about me. In 1 John 3:17, the Lord put it this way, but whoso hath this world's goods, and see his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? Well, you've got the goods of this old world. God's given them to you graciously. And then you see your brother in need, but you won't help. How can you say the love of God is in you? That's what the Lord is trying to get this lawyer to see. Then major point number 11, Luke 10, 35. And on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, take care of him. And whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. He gave 2 pence to help take care of the injured man. 2 days' wages, according to the Zondervan Pictorial Bible Dictionary, page 554. Would you give up 2 days' wages to help a stranger? You don't even know who he is, but he's fallen among thieves. Here's a man who did. He also said that he would repay any amount above that which was used when he returned. That was his attitude. Major point 12. In Luke 10, 36, which now of these 3 thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? The Lord wants to know now which of the 3 in this parable was indeed a neighbor. Since the lawyer did not know who his neighbor was at the start, Jesus asked him which of these 3 was a neighbor. The answer, of course, is obvious. In major point number 13, which is Luke 10, 37, he said, he that showed mercy on him, Then said Jesus unto him, Go and do thou likewise. Notice he would not say the Samaritan. He's not about to say that word. So he says, the one that showed the mercy. That's the neighbor. He got the answer right again, but would he put it into practice? This is the issue. Jesus told him to go and do likewise. That's what you and I've got to do. Go and do likewise. Well, hurriedly, let's look at some lessons that we can learn from this great parable. Number one, there needs to be a proper motive for a Bible study. Now, here's a lawyer that does not really care about the proper motive for Bible study. He's trying to ensnare our Lord, tempt him, and trap him. But instead, the lawyer himself got into trouble. Number two, worship should transform our lives. If we're going to go worship the Lord and say we love the Lord and we love our fellow man, when we leave there and we stumble upon someone who's been injured, then friends, we need to administer to his needs. Otherwise, worship has not done much for us. Number three, knowledge of the law only makes us aware of what is right. See, we know right from wrong, but again, will we put it into practice? Number four, true love is doing good and not merely professing it. Oh, you think about that priest and that Levite, they probably talked about how much they loved the Lord, how much they loved their fellow man, but they did not show it by the way that they lived. Number five, Christians are to do good to all men. See, this man was a Samaritan. It may well be the case the one who was hurt was a Jew. But he did good to him anyway and helped him. And that's what you and I need to do. Then number six, one who renders help to us when we are in need is our real neighbor, not just somebody who talks a good game. Number seven, prejudice should not hinder us from doing good. And then number eight, it is not enough to know the truth. We must put it into practice. Well, we've seen many wonderful truths in this parable of the Good Samaritan. My advice to you is go and do likewise. That was the Lord's advice. And may God help us to put all these wonderful principles into practice. And may God bless you as you continue to study the parables of Jesus Christ.
This is a production of World Video Bible School. To God be the glory.